This special lecture by Professor Nair. Before that, it is my another privilege to invite Professor Ganaran sir, the president of our Tamil Moriyal Sangam, to say a few words to the august audience here, sir. Please, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Ravi, and also to all the honorable members of this august body. I just wanted to convey my inikina, or I happened to see conveying letter for appointment of Dr. Nadarasa Pillai and our Ram Murthy as mentor professors by the Bardiyar University. Along with them, we four former HODs of that department, me, Dr. Shanmugam, Dr. Dayalan, and Dr. Muthukishanan also have been nominated to that position. It is really an honor offered by the university. Officially it has happened. So I should thank on behalf of the Tamil Moriyal Sangam for giving this importance to serve the our discipline in some way or other, and also their confidence in our studies and in our work. That is one thing. Another thing, I should congratulate the Vice Chancellor of the Tamil University, our secretary, distinguished Dr. G. Balasubramaniam, recommending the three names to be nominated for the Tamil University Senate once in 2 years, 3 years that happens. This time, it so happened that all the three scholars recommended for that position, all linguists, Dr. Pasumbon, Dr. Selvakumar, and Dr.
Saranya.
Of the three universities, two universities and the International Institute of Tamil Studies. So we should thank the government of Tamil Nadu, the Honorable Chancellor, Excellency, the Chancellor, and also the distinguished Vice Chancellor of that university for giving this opportunity, you know, to serve the community in whichever way possible, academically. You see, I was really happy when all the three informed me about their nominations, and thanks on behalf of the body, the Tamil Linguistics, Tamil Moriyal Sangam. That's why I just wanted to congratulate them and see that our contributions will go on in whatever way possible, and for giving this opportunity for our scholars, our members, to do their whatever bit possible during the coming years. That's why I wanted to interfere. And now I call upon our senior professor, Dr. Rajasekhar Nair, to give his lecture on his experience. And
thank you, sir.
Hello.
Thank you very much, sir.
Hello.
Sir, microphone is muted. You please unmute sir's microphone.
Okay. Thank you, sir. It is a pleasure. It is a honor that you have taken your time to greet the very distinguished linguists who have been given a responsible position in different universities. I thank you, sir, for the kind words and blessing, sir. And I think it is time to invite to start the lecture. And I invite Professor Chandramohan to welcome the audience. Thank you, sir. Dr. Chandramohan.
Chandramohan, please unmute your mic.
Chandramohan, you
unmute. Ah, sir, okay, sir. Is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, audible now.
Unmute. Yeah. Please unmute.
Please.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Sir.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. So, அனைவருக்கும் தமிழ் மொழியியல் சங்கத்தின் சார்பாக இனிய மாலை வணக்கம். மோஸ்ட் ரெஸ்பெக்டட் ப்ரொஃபசர் கே கருணாகரன் சார், பிரசிடென்ட் தமிழ் மொழியியல் சங்கம், ஃபார்மர் வைஸ் சான்சலர் தமிழ் யூனிவர்சிட்டி தஞ்சாவூர், மோஸ்ட் ரெஸ்பெக்டட் ப்ரொஃபசர் ஜி பாலசுப்ரமணியன் சார், செக்ரட்டரி தமிழ் மொழியியல் சங்கம் அண்ட் பிரசிடென்ட் வைஸ் சான்சலர் தமிழ் யூனிவர்சிட்டி தஞ்சாவூர், ரெஸ்பெக்டட் ப்ரொஃபசர் ராஜசேகர் நாயர், ஃபார்மர் டைரக்டர் சென்டர் ஆஃப் அட்வான்ஸ் ஸ்டடி இன் லிங்குஸ்டிக்ஸ் அண்ணாமலை யூனிவர்சிட்டி, அண்ட் டுடே ஸ்பீக்கர் organizing committee members professor ravishankar, professor muralidharan and other members of this association as well as the organizing committee members, senior respected senior professors, dear participants, good evening one and all. I extend warm welcome to all at the webinar of our association. It is my great honor and pleasure to introduce and welcome today's speaker professor N. Rajasekharan Nayar. Professor N. Rajasekharan Nayar studied MA linguistics at Center of Advanced Study in Linguistics, Annamalai University, and passed the examination ES class, securing second rank in 1972. He did his PhD under the guidance of Professor S. Agastilingam in the topic auxiliary verbs in Malayalam, and the same was published by Annamalai University during 1981. He got many diploma degrees like Kannada, Tamil, French in first class from Annamalai University. He is conversant in Malayalam, Tamil, Kannada, Bengali, Hindi, French, and English. Professor Rajasekharan Nayar joined as lecturer at Annamalai University in 1976 and retired as professor of linguistics in the year 2008. He served as the director, Center of Advanced Study in Linguistics for 2 years. Further, he served as professor and head, Department of Language, Hadramaut University, Republic of Yemen for 2 years. He has visited many countries like France, Germany, Malaysia, Singapore, Hong Kong, Netherlands, Republic of Yemen, and Sultanate of Oman for academic pursuits. He has successfully guided 9 scholars for PhD and 5 candidates for their MPhil programs. His area of specialization was generative syntax, language teaching, and tribal linguistics. He has evaluated more than 30 PhD dissertations, mostly from various universities in India like Calcutta University, Calicut University, Bharathiyar University, Sipal Hyderabad, IFLU Hyderabad, Mahatma Gandhi University, Osmania University, Telangu University, Gandhigram Rural University, and Delhi University, etc. About his career related activities, he occupied many key positions at Annamalai University during his service, like member academic council, member senate, member internal quality assurance cell, member advisory committee, and UGC ASHIS deputy coordinator, UGC SAP, Annamalai University. Further, he has held a series of positions like member of peer team of NAC, member executive committee, Trevidian Linguistics Association, member publication committee, Linguistic Society of India, chairman Linguistic Research Committee, Indian Academy of Social Sciences, and member Tamil Moliyar Sangam. He served as member and chairman for Board of Studies in Linguistics for Annamalai University, Madras University, Gandhigram Rural University, Tamil University, Bharathiyar University, Sri Venkateswara University, MS University, Dr. R.C. Haramath Institute of Kannada Studies, Dharwad, etc. He served as member of selection committees in various universities like Osmania University, Gandhigram Rural University, Madurai Kamaraj University, Bharathiyar University, Tamil University, Trevidian University, Central University of Kerala, etc. He has presented more than 120 research papers in the national and international seminars and conferences. He delivered special lecture on speech varieties of tribals of Kerala and Tamil and Malayalam, the relationship of two Dravidian languages at the Institute of Indology and Tamil Studies, University of Kiel, Germany, and more than 5 lectures at the Laboratory of Languages and Civilization at Tradition Orly, Paris. He has completed 4 major research projects sponsored by various agencies in the field of linguistics. He was awarded the Certificate of Merit for long and dedicated services from Annamalai University in 2004 and received Guru Dakshina Award from Dakshina Cultural Association Chennai in 2012. So it is so impossible to mention his all accomplishments because they are not. Today we are in the program through web to hear his standing speech. We are really thankful to him for taking the time out of his busy schedule to deliver the special lecture. We are certainly grateful to him for accepting our invitation gladly to become the resource person of this webinar to deliver the lecture on Tamil diaspora in France. With this brief introduction, on behalf of Tamil Mudiyar Sangam, I welcome you, sir, to deliver your valuable lecture. Well, once again, I welcome one and all. Thank you.
So can I start now? Hello.
Sir, please start now.
Sorry, you can start, sir.
Okay. Tamil Mudiyar Sangam President, Professor Karunakaran, General Secretary, Professor Balasubramanian, the coordinators, Dr. Chandramohan, Dr. Kumaresan, Dr. Muralitharan, Dr. Sundarbabu, and others. I'm happy to thank all these persons for inviting me to deliver today's lecture. And also I'm congratulating the people who has been organizing this without any break from the beginning. Before I start my lecture, let me congratulate the newly appointed mentor professors, Dr. Narajapillai, Dr. Ramamurthy, and 4 former HODs of Bharatiya University Linguistics Department. Thank you for that. Now let me start. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Next slide by Ramamurthy. Sundarbalu?
Yes, sir. I am here, sir.
Change pannungala.
You change the slide, Dr. Sundarbalu.
Slide, Matan.
Okay. So I'm just starting my lecture. What is diaspora? The involuntary mass dispersion of a population from its indigenous territories. The word diaspora is derived from Greek. Okay, next one. The introduction, I used to say that the migration of people from one country to another country of different language is an age-old phenomenon. But this has assumed new proportion after the Second World War. Indians migrated to European countries in large numbers. Within the Indian speakers, Tamil language speakers have migrated not only to various parts of Asia, but also to various countries of Europe in large numbers. The migration of Tamil speakers to France is as old as 4 or 5 decades, and the second generation of Tamil speakers are now living in France. An attempt is made in this paper to study the plight of Tamils in Paris who are trying to retain their mother tongue. Data on Malayala speakers are also analyzed here. The Tamil speakers, when we say Tamil speaker, there are two groups. One is Indian Tamils, another is Sri Lankan Tamils. Who are actually Indian Tamils? The Tamil speakers who have migrated from Pondicherry and Karaikal are the main Tamil speakers who have settled down in Paris. And also, there are people from all over Tamil Nadu, or different parts of Tamil Nadu, who speak Tamil. They have also settled down in Paris. They are called as Indian Tamils. Who are Sri Lankan Tamils? The people from Sri Lanka who speak Tamil, who has, after the civil war there during 80s and 70s, they have migrated to Paris and they have gone to different places. As we know that the Sri Lankan Tamils have gone to different places as refugees in Australia, in Germany, Canada, India, and also in France. So these Sri Lankan Tamils are also settled there. And regarding the population, there is a problem over population. Indian Tamils, in an unofficial recording, it is said that 57,600 people are available in Paris and suburbs. So this, why this is not clear is that when these Indian Tamils are settled down in Paris and France, they are considered to be the citizens. So they are not considered to considered as aliens. So the number, they are part of the French culture, French people, etc. So the number is not valid, not much valid. And for the Sri Lankan Tamils, again, the same thing, they have come, they have gone there in huge numbers in different timings. Some they may be around 120,000 to 150,000 as per some reports. But this data is also not very clear about that. Okay, then data collection. So I have been there in Paris and suburbs under the UGC scheme, Indo-Cultural Exchange Program during 2001 and 2006. And I have collected data from these Tamil speakers. As we know that when one group of speakers settle down in another place where some other language is spoken, the language will attract many changes. And here also, those things are noted. So for data collection, I have used two methods. One is questionnaire method, another is interview method. What is questionnaire method is, I have gone there with a questionnaire of about some 40 questions, some 4 pages or 5 pages, 40 questions, normal questions, to elicit data of their attitude, their willingness to learn French language, their way of life, etc., etc., about some 4 to 5 pages. But that was in a way a failure, because it was very difficult to get these people, because these Tamils, as well as the Malayalis, they have settled down in different places and scattered in different places. Get them is very difficult. And I have met some persons in some places and gave 2 or 3 copies to someone, requesting them to return to me after 2 or 3 days. Let me tell you that nobody has returned any of those things. Then I considered that practice was not sound. As we do the fieldwork here in Tamil Nadu or in other places in India, that kind of questionnaire distribution may be possible. Even we send through post or through SMS or sometimes through mail, etc. That is possible. But here, that was not at all possible. Then I thought of having the interview method. That went on very well. In the sense that the same questionnaire I used with an interview method, I have to meet the persons and also I ask the same questions to them. And the answers I wrote down immediately. So I took around some 1 hour or 2 hours with one person like that. So all the questions they have, all the relevant questions they have answered. So answers I have written down, and I analyzed it. That is actually the totality of my lecture. So in the interview method, so I'm showing here some pictures of some people. That's more important because the family structure is very important. When they have gone to a different country of different language, the family structure is very important. I don't know how to explain this. The cursor moves to a person. Can you see now? The cursor is moving to a person in the photograph. Can Sundarabalu?
Please share the. Please share.
No.
We can see it.
So we choose the next slide.
Yeah, we can see your cursor moving. Don't worry.
Cursor is on a particular person, right? His name is Dr. Muniyappa Nathan Joseph. He is from Pondicherry. He is a converted Christian. At that time, he is no more now. Some 2 months ago, he passed away. And he has been teaching Tamil in a very good university, Professor University of Dauphin, and he was the General Secretary of France Tamil Sangam till his death. So, what I want to suggest, tell you is that he was there for about 35 years in the university, has been teaching Tamil to the native speakers of French. And his wife is from Vietnam. He has three children of different ages. The problem is that he tried to teach or he tried to speak to the children in Tamil. And his wife is very adamant that she wants to speak only in Vietnamese to the children. But ultimately what happened was that whenever in the home domain, whenever all these five are available, they have to compulsorily switch over to French. So this information, he only gave it. So even though he was a Tamil professor, it was not possible for him to teach his own children the Tamil pronunciation, Tamil sentences, etc. And number two is Dr. the previous slide, Dr. Appasamy Murugayan, probably most of you know. He has, his wife is a French woman, the previous one. And he has two sons. At that time when I was there, they may be around some 20 years old, 21 or so old. I interviewed them. I elicited data from them. There also, I recorded also. There also what happened was that in the home domain house, there was no question of the use of Tamil at all. The Murugai, Dr. Murugayan has been teaching Tamil to two different universities and a researcher in one place. Three places he has been working. But he used to speak to his wife in Tamil and sometimes in Tamil and most of the time in French. And the two children, they may not recognize the Tamil words. So naturally, among themselves, the two children among themselves, they speak only through French. And they speak to the parents also in French. And when I asked them certain questions with my questionnaire, they have given some answers, theorem, some, etc. But most of the time, they have been mixing French words in there. And also, they have been searching for Tamil nouns or Tamil verbs. So that is because they are born there, they don't have any contact with any Tamil people except his father. And the father also need not use Tamil at home also because his wife is a French woman. So this is their situation. I'm giving all these information. This family structure is very much important when we analyze the diaspora situations. Okay, next slide, please. Here, the right hand side top, there's a person. he is from Karakar. And his name is Mani, and his wife is wearing a sari. And you look at the two children, his two children, they are just like Indians, or just like Tamil children. And when I interviewed them, they were there for about 6 years at that time. And Mr. Mani was telling me that we will live in Paris just like Tamil people. So he says that he will stick on to speak Tamil, as well as to stick on to the Tamil culture only. That's why he said, you look at my children. They are wearing a shirt and a knicker as Tamil children wear. So this was his impression. I don't know what happened next. He was working in a lab and his wife was working in a supermarket near to their house, supermarket. So his intention was that he has to live in Paris like Tamil couple. Okay, the photo down, the previous. Down is also a Tamil speaker. He's also from Karakal. The left hand side, his name is Muhammad. He is wearing a dhoti or a lungi at home. And right hand corner, his wife are wearing a sari. And her name is Hijra. And they have three children. First one is daughter, second two sons, second and third, two sons. So here I have to mention one thing. that most of the house, Tamil houses I visited, the couple, they have three children. Reason is that the government of France, has given many concessions to the couple who have three children and more. The reason is that the French people, the ladies are very careful about their body structure. So most of the French families, you may not find even a single child. And the ladies will be doing so much of exercises to make their body fit. And if they are fat, they say that a divorce is also possible. So that's why now we find that in France, all over France, we find the older generation people are more in number than youngsters. So in one time, a point of time, a few years ago, the French government has announced that we want younger generation people, either from this French side or from the migrated side. So taking that into queue, our Tamil friends, most of the houses, they have three children. So they are fortunate that they have been getting so much of concessions, like train concession, flight concession, education concession, and so many things. So they are happily settled there. Okay. Next one is, about the prominent Malayalis. The right hand side, the top, there is an old man sitting. His name is Balakrishnan. At that time, he was about 85 years old when I was collecting data from him. There also, his wife is a French lady. At that time, she was no more. And he has only one son. His name is Kalidas. He was working in London. Paris to London, flight time is almost 1 hour. So only monthly once or et cetera, he comes home. His name is an Indian name. This old gentleman was working in the film industry in France. From his, he said that he was the first person to reach Paris from India. There were, he said, along with him, there were other two persons. Those two persons already they have died. So these three persons from Mahi have come to Pondicherry, stayed there for a few months. Then they went to Bombay. From Bombay only they have gone to illegally to Paris. And he was an electrical engineer, and so he called it a sound engineer. And he was able to say so many words in Malayalam, and he gave Malayalam sentences also. When I was conversing with him, in a way it was good. Although his family structure is that he is a Malayali and his wife was a French woman, and his son, only son, his name is Indian name, he's Kalidasan, etc. And he has certain accusations or in a way problems with the actors, of Indian actors. And he was asking me why Indian actors like Mohanlal and Kamala Hassan are acting in more than 5 or 6 movies in a year. So he says that in French situation, one actor or actress will be acting only for one movie because perfection is more important. And as a sound engineer, he says that everything is important. So he notices all these things. And all these informations he gave during the interviews. But that was true. I was staying during this period for a month or so. I was staying in a guest house in a common place where there are about some 50 or 60 buildings. They called belong to different countries. And I was very near to the roadside building. So I saw one day there are some truckloads of things are coming near to my flat or apartment or room. And second day some more, third day some more, like that it went on for about a week or so. Then only I came to know that there was a shooting, movie shooting. And they were having these equipments for about 10 days. They are taking lights on during night hours. and daytime they are looking at the looking at the shadows of trees, movement of shadows, sun's light, moonlight, all these things they have been going on checking. And finally, after 15 days or so, the shooting was conducted. The shooting was only for about for half an hour or 1 hour. So what this Balakrishnan was telling, that they are taking meticulous care in having the movies. So this I have seen with my own eyes. Okay, the second photograph, and a weird man, his name is Paris Vishwanathan. He's a sculptor as well as a painter. His wife is French, and he is from Kerala, from Kollam, and he has come to Chennai for his studies, and later moved to Paris, and last some 45 years, he is in Paris, a well-known figure in Paris, a celebrity there. And the third photograph is also, third one, the bottom, his name is Akritam Narayanan, the weird person. Akritam Narayanan is a painter. Painter means not our painting, painter means artist. So he has been painting, he is a good painter, he has won so many national, international awards. His paintings are displayed in Germany and France, in India and many countries. And he is very famous for his sculpture as well as the paintings. And here also the family structure is that. And when I was interviewing him, he gave the information in Malayalam. His Malayalam was good. And also I asked him, can you sing any Malayalam song? And he said he was song the two lines. Those two lines, that means some 30, 40 years ago, which appeared in movie. So he was, that time, he was in the Malayalam field, and afterwards he forgot everything, but he has been moving with, in France also, he is moving with many people. At least once in a year, he comes to Kerala, and he has not forgotten his language. But his family structure is that his wife is a Japanese lady, and he has only one son. His son, his name is Agni. Agni is a peculiar name, and he is also a painter. He told me, this doctor, Mr. Akritam Narayanan told me that I used to speak Malayalam with others, and with my wife only, I don't know Japanese, with French, with my son also French. So naturally, in this family situation, as we have seen earlier, they all speak French among themselves. Okay, the next slide, please. Here, another person is that, his name is Gopinathan Nair. He is working Indian embassy for about more than 25 years. His wife is also from Kerala. Her name is Shobha. He has two daughters. One is Sangeeta, another is Rathika, born and educated in Paris. Now we can think of the Gopinathan Nair speaks French because of his official duties in the Indian embassy. His wife is not employed, and at home they try to speak Malayalam, but both the daughters, they never speak Malayalam. They very skeleton Malayalam they know. And with even fellow Malayali girls, they speak only French. This is the situation in their house. This photograph now is shown. I will tell you now, the right-hand side, there is a person. His name is Surendran Nair. Surendran Nair, he is an ordinary person, but a very wealthy person in Paris. He was a proprietor of three textile marts there. One is called Nair Sab, second is called City Girl, third is called Sari Land. There are three textile shops he is owning, and he has employed many persons there from India and as well as from Sri Lanka. So what is important is that his wife is also from Kerala. Her name is Valsala, and he has only one daughter. She's born there in Paris, and she speaks only French because of her. And another, these persons how Tamil is propagated by the Tamil people. I will come later, but since this photograph I am showing, I will tell you these Malayalam people are the persons, Malayalam speakers, they are not taking any special effort to teach Malayalam to their own children. Mainly the home Romayan, that's not possible because both the parents may not talk to them in Malayalam. The children use only French to the parents also. They are comfortable with that. The other thing is that there is no particular effort, but there is a Kerala Cultural Association formed by them. And this Mr. Gobinathan Nair, who is working in the Indian Embassy for more than 25 years, he told me that about 150 Kerala people as per the passport are here in Paris, and maybe another some 50 or so, they are Malayalis. They may be students, maybe temporary, 1 year, 2 year, 3 years like that. So altogether, there may be around some 200 Malayalis are there. The problem with them was that all of them were away from, scattered in different parts. So coming together is a difficult problem. Although they have an association called Kerala Cultural Association, they will the gatherings will be there only for yearly once or so, like Onam, etc., etc. That's all. Otherwise, there is no cultural association function. This photo, which I have taken, which was taken, I am also there in an occasion. This I can say that this is a kind of promoting Malayalam language. So every Saturday evening, after their work, about some 7:30 or so, a few Malayalis in the place called Gardino, they will gather in this hall. This hall means not a official hall. This is a Mr. Surendran Nair's textiles upstairs, where they will gather there. They will sit together. They will talk for about 2 hours. They will have their drinks there. And one person is a very good cook. He will cook chicken biryani every evening. I was also fortunate to have their chicken biryani on that day. The language promotion is that this red shirt is the secretary. He's Biji John. Biji John is a secretary of the Kerala Cultural Association. They will speak, the conversation will be only in Malayalam. Sometimes monthly once or at least once in a month, one may go to Kerala. And that person has to come here and explain what were their things, what he has seen, where he has gone, what are the things happening in Kerala, in his hometown, in his village, etc., etc. So this is actually a kind of thing which they cherish. That means, although they are in a city, it's a very good city, that is Paris, they want to hear from a native person what is happening to others in Kerala. So that situation they have created in this kind of gathering. And again, there will be about Andhashari for half an hour, then some movie songs by them, about 10 to 15 minutes. So totally, they enjoy the life for about 2 hours every evening Saturday. So what I find is, although this is a smaller group, this is a kind of a language promotion. Okay. Then the another person and the previous one, then also I will explain the previous one, previous. Another person, his name is Inasu Talak in 5. His wife's name is Elsie. She was a nurse. He's sitting in the right hand side. I don't know how you cannot see or not. Right hand side, he's sitting. His name is Inasu Talak. He's from Kerala, Thrissur. His wife is also from Thrissur. Her name is Elsie. She was a nurse. They have only one daughter. Her name is Mallika. The problem is that Mallika speaks only very little. She may be, at that time, she may be about some 22 years. And she was born in Paris, educated there as a law graduate. And she was interested in Bharatanatyam. She learned Bharatanatyam there. And after some time, she came to Chennai, in the Kalashetra. Kalashetra is a dance performing place, very famous one, where she was there for about 6 months. she learned Bharatanatyam also. So like that, this Vinasu is a language lover. He is also writing articles to some Malayalam journals, and he has published a Malayalam book about Malayalam cinema, like that, etc. But he speaks good Malayalam to everybody. Okay, next one, please. Here, two important places of Tamil speaker. When I say two important places, mean the city, the Paris city and suburbs, or city itself is a very huge area. The Tamils are concentrated at one place, and also it is. I found that the French government, they have a very good town plan. They have allotted places for each ethnic groups. So I have visited some of those places. Once I went to a place where it's a very long street. I can see only black people, utter black people. As we will see, as if we are in Senegal or in South Africa. So that place or that street, I don't know the name now. That street was totally given, allotted for the black people. And they have been given there. They have come there as refugees. They have been given some some kind of a job also. Their job is they are skilled workers, or can say skilled in some like beauticians, hair dressers, something like that. So that street we will see only the black people. In another day, in another street where I visited, I saw only Chinese people. I said, we will see that we are in Wuhan. So like that, those people may be working in restaurants as well as in malls, etc. So only Chinese people. So here, the Tamils, I mentioned here one place is called Little India, another is Little Jaffna. And those who have visited Singapore may know that there is a place called Little India, where most of the Indians are settled there in the place called Little India in Singapore. Likewise, in Paris also, there is a place called Little India. Probably this is not an official name, but it is known like that. There's a place called Gardeno. The spelling is Gardenord. This meaning is that the North Railway Station. North means north. Gare means railway station. The pronunciation may be something like Gardeno. They pronounce it as Gardeno. So Gardeno is the name of a railway station. Very near to that, this place is there, Little India, where you can see the Indian restaurants and Sri Lankan restaurants, etc. All Tamil restaurants you will find there, and also the grocery shops. So anything you want as an Indian, anything you want to buy, you can buy in this place that is Gardeno. Earlier I said that Mr. Surendra Nair was having three textile shops. All the three are situated only in this place. So the Indian goods, what all you want to buy, very good stuff you can get from this Little India place. And Little Jaffna is a different place. You can think that when I say Little Jaffna means, the Sri Lankan people are settled only there. They move to this Gardeno place, and also they are seen, mostly they are seen in one place that is called Little Jaffna. So the town planning shows that the people of different ethnic groups are settled down in different places. Likewise, I visited, I wanted to see that Mr. Akitam Narayanan, the artist, they call as a painter. Then I telephoned him and also got his appointment and with his house. There also I found the same kind of situation. There are about seven or eight apartments nearby, independent bungalows nearby. They call it as a painter's village. That was allotted by the government for the painters. So all these painters are in one place. Painters means all these artists are in one place. So like that, the town planning is also good. The next one, I have given some restaurants. You will just find out why I am giving this one. We have seen the restaurants like Krishna Bhavan. As you know, these are found in Chennai. For Chennai, there is, you may not think, oh, what is what? You may not have anything to tell about this. But when the same is found in a place where that is a requirement, it's a vegetarian restaurant. Then next one is a Muniyandi Villas. The another one is a Saravana Bhavan vegetarian. Then a Coffee Anjappar. Then Kasturi is the name of that restaurant. Then Naan is a restaurant. And Marcel is another restaurant. All these restaurants are run by the Tamil community. And the Marcel, the seventh one, Naan, is by a Mauritian brother and sister. But they are also Tamil speakers. So why I am giving this is to show that we Indians or the Tamils have a kind of soft power to influence the rest of the world. What is soft power means? We don't have much money. We don't have other powers like military power. But when you are in other land, other people's land, you can also influence the person there. And these restaurants, those French people also visit. They frequent these. They like our idli and dosa, chutney, sambar, etc. So, in a way, our people, Tamil people, are showing this softer power with them. Softer power not only with the restaurants, with so many other things, or like our Indian or Tamil temples, and also our dresses, then martial art. One day I was walking in a place near to my apartment. I saw one guru was teaching Siramamadi. What is that? I don't know. Siramamadi means that was found in Kanyakumari district as well as in Tirunelveli. Silambam. So the French people are learning Silambam. So like that, in that way, we, the Tamils, are maintaining a kind of soft power. And it is, they are attracted with this. Okay, next one, please. Next one. Next slide, please. Then I'm just suggesting some temples. I have given here only four. I have visited almost all the temples there. One is Ganesha temple. Another is Ganesha Hindu temple. Another is Sri Ashtalashmi Devasthana. Another is Shivan Koil. Then Krishna temple. So there are a few more temples are also there. The pujas are done by our Tamil people there. And the ulsavams, festivals are conducted as we do in our places like Pongal and other places it is there. And during their birthdays, etc. Tamil people used to visit such temples. So, in a country where the Christianity is in power, they have allowed the Hindu temples. And mostly, I have stated earlier that there are two kinds of Tamils. One is Indian Tamils and another is Sri Lankan Tamils. Sri Lankan Tamils prefer to go to these, they are more pious people. They wish to go to the these temples, and Indian Tamils also visit, and more than 50% of Indian Tamils are either Christians or converted Christians, and there are Hindus also. Yes, next one, please. So here I mentioned some activities of Sri Lankan Tamils to retain and maintain Tamil language and culture. So what is actually their effort to maintain the language? I will just go through this and then I will let you know. The only one Tamil association for Sri Lankans, that is called as Tamil Shole. Only one, they call it only one Tamil association, that is called as Tamil Shole. And they have some 52 centers in Paris. And this 52, this number may not be exactly right now, because when I elicited data, they said that there are 52 centers. All the centers are named only by the name Tamil Shole. Classes will be held during Wednesdays and Saturdays. About 2 hours classes will be there. there they teach Tamil language and Tamil civilization. Nominal fee is charged from the Tamil children. And two, they have a Tamil national television in a place called Lakur Nev. Three, another one, Tamil reminiscent television, TRT, from a place called Gobigni. Two television channels which they manage, the Sri Lankan Tamil. Another channel is also there, that is called Tamil Oli. There, certain timings, they have, they used to telecast Sun TV programs also. Another one is Deva TV channel, which is also run by them. Sixth one is Asia Radio. That is for 24 hours, it is there. Then the seventh one is Tamil movies are shown during Saturdays and Sundays in a place called Anvers. Good crowd is there. The last one is they have magazines like Eeranadu and Eeramurasa. Two weeklies are published from Paris by these people. The last one I cannot see. The last one. Okay. So here what I want to emphasize is that they are taking much sincere efforts to retain the language, maintain the language. The last one, ninth, is the Tamil weeklies like Kumudam, Rani, Tenathandi are available there in the Gardano area. These people come there and collect it. Okay, next one. The next one is activities of Indian Tamils to retain and maintain Tamil language and culture. 17 Tamil associations are there. So for Sri Lankan Tamils, only Tamil Sholai is only one name. But they have in different places, 56 places. But for our Indian Tamils, they have many, many Tamil associations. Here I have given 17 Tamil associations. This is not an exhaustive list. Like France Indian Sociocultural Association of a place called Guinea. That is only meant for the members only from Pondicherry and Karaikal. Another is Federation of Franco-Indian Association. The president is Professor Dasharathan. The third one is France Tamil Sangam. President is Mr. Paris Jamal. You know, because I have given here only three such associations. It is said that there are about 17 Tamil associations at that time with the different names. Then no schools run by them to teach Tamil to their children. These children go to schools run by Sri Lankan Tamils. Why? You may be now wondering why they are not conducting school for the Tamil children. The first is that these Indian Tamils are considered to be French citizens. So they are not a different ethnic group. And some years ago, actually they all will have a French passport. And whenever they want to come to India, Tamil Nadu, they have to request for a visa to visit, and they have to pay money in the Indian embassy also. But later, about six years ago, the government of France has given another chance for our people that they call as a OCI, other citizen of India. That's a token given, that's a ticket given for the Tamils and the Indians. OCI means other citizen of India. So whenever they have no dual citizenship, whenever they want to come to India, to Tamil Nadu, they can use that one. They need not go in for a visa. So this is the thing there. So these children go to schools run by Sri Lankan Tamils. Here also there is a very important thing. Why they go to, I will take another 5 minutes or so. Tamils in the sense that their Tamil is not correct. They say that, the Sri Lankans say that the Indian Tamil is Kochi Tamil. That's only not a good Tamil. And these Indian Tamils now adopt Sri Lankan. The Indian people settled in France, they adopt Sri Lankan Tamil. So they send their children also to Sri Lankan. secondary school, so that their children learn a standard. That's all. The next one, please. This already we have stated. Yes, next one. Next one, please. Here about the Malayali situation, I said that no sincere effort by them. About 200 to 250 Malayalis are living in different parts in Paris and suburbs. They have a Kerala Consular Association, etc., etc. The secretary is Mr. Surendra Nair, president is Mr. Vijay John. At that moment when I visited there, a few Malayalam weeklies and dailies are available. One situation here also I will mention. This is similar to the Tamil situation. Something that Mr. Jose is working in Indian Embassy for over 20 years. His wife, Jolie, is in Paris for 16 years. They speak to each other in Malayalam and French. 10-year-old daughter speaks Malayalam with parents. Five-year-old son speaks only French, no Malayalam. So the youngest boy is moving with the French people. So this situation is seen in, as we have seen in Tamil situation, Mr. Mudiyappan's house. This situation is prevalent in many places among Malayalis also. And another situation also I will tell you, I went to a Malayalam family the wife's name is Prasanna. She hails from Haripadu in Kerala. She was a journalist, and her husband is a Frenchman. Name is Alan Grisilon. There is a funny situation. This person went to Mutt in Kerala, Shivagiri Matham in Kerala, for worshipping. There he met this lady, and who was a journalist. The first sight, they were in love. And this man asked her, can we marry? And she said yes. And both of them married there and came to Paris. Then only the problem started, because she knows English and Malayalam. He knows only French, no English, no Malayalam. But with the foot of a computer, the software, what all she wants, she will type in English, and he will convert them into French, and he will do the rest. Like that, it went on for a month or so. Then she went for a course, crash program in French, and she learned French language. And then they started speaking in French. At that time, when I visited them, they had one and a half year old girl. And that girl, they have been teaching only French language. So naturally, that girl, when she grows up, she will learn only the French language. This is another situation. Okay, then I have given some, next slide shows that French Malayalis, I just named the French Malayalis, because I met some Malayali people, both male and female, who have some connection with Malayalam. The first one is Martini Shamana. She's a French lady. She learned Malayalam from Trivandrum, from Professor V.R. Prabhakaran Nair, and she has been doing some translation. She's a translator performing arts, language and history. Another is Gilles Darabot. He is an ethnologist, and Iva Silly, a language performing arts specialization. Dominic Vivalus, translator. Then Vijiri Johar, PhD research scholar. Pudiyattam is a Malayalam performing arts. So that person has been doing PhD in Kerala to get the PhD in Pudiyattam. So all these five French speakers, they have learned Malayalam to do their own. Okay, next one. So the attitude of Malayalis, that is also some important. So I've asked them, in the course of my interviews, I asked women prefer to live in Paris. Why? They get more respect and equal status here. They used the word, Ivada Yellaram Egalitayana. Egalite is a French word. French word they use in the Malayalam sentence. Ivada Yellaram Egalitayana. Egalite equal. Here everyone is equal. Everybody is equal. Equal status here. Here husband and wife share all the household works. The women, when they go to Kerala for a vacation, they cannot tolerate where they see only women doing the whole house or household work. They did not like to see men either watch TV or read newspaper while women are working in the kitchen. In France, insurance, that's another important thing. In France, insurance and social security are better. The teenage girls, when they contact them, who were born in France, teenage in the sense that 20 years, 22 years, they do not want to return to Kerala. According to them, the young men in Kerala unnecessarily ridiculed them. That means that kind of attitude they don't like. Okay, then cultural retention. Next one, I'm talking about cultural retention. So language retention, we have seen now, conducting rituals and ceremonies, that's important. If possible, the diasporas conducted the important rituals in their homeland, that means in Tamil Nadu. So I'm just suggesting two situations. One is Dr. Durai, Associate Professor, CS Linguistics and Anomaly University, conducted his daughter's marriage at Pondicherry recently. The bridegroom, he is from Pondicherry, is a resident of France for a long time. The marriage was celebrated in Pondicherry with elaborate ceremonies, befitting the traditional Tamil culture. I participated in that. Second slide. Dr. Murugayan conducted his son's marriage at Pondicherry. The girl is a French person. The rituals were held as per the Tamil culture and tradition. The same function, Dr. Murugayan conducted the ear piercing for his granddaughter. The photo is also seen there. Daughter about 2 years. In the function, his wife and daughters-in-law were wearing Indian traditional costumes, saris. The reasons for conducting the ritual in the homeland may be the following, because that's my idea, that the materials needed for such rituals are available in the homeland. Two, the close relatives will be present in large numbers to offer their blessings. Okay, the next slide, please. The Indian couple settled in France, Indian names to their children. So here, already we have seen some, please. The Indians, Tamil people, Malayalis, or even others, they try to give only Indian names to their children. The first is Dr. Murugayan, his wife's name is Pascal, French. But the another name was given to her, Indumali. Whenever she comes to India, in Dr. Murugayan's house, she is called only as Hindu or Indumali. And they have named their son as Ishwar and Vivek. Then another is Dr. Vasant Raichu. He was the professor of French in Karnataka University, and later he became the registrar there. His wife's name is Dr. Kalchan Pillow Raichu. And their sons names are Anand and Vikram. Anand and Vikram, Indian names. Okay, next one. So like that, earlier also, we have shown many Indian names. So Indian language in diaspora, these are two words which I have, I wanted to tell you that there are two important words, one is Indian languages in diaspora. Another is, edited by Appaswamy Murugayan, 2019. The next one is the Indian diaspora, Dynamics of Diaspora, edited by N. J. Raman, New Delhi, Sage Publications, 2004. Now, I wish to give you, which is not there in the slides, I wish to tell you my impression about the fieldwork. One observations about the PIPAR analysis, one is there are many Tamil children, both male and female, of the age group of 1 to 18. Two, most of the children are not able to speak in Tamil. They are not able to read or write Tamil. Very few children speak Tamil with parents. Four, the parents in many families speak only in Tamil with the children to make them learn language. Five, the children among themselves speak only in French. Six, the children who speak Tamil with parents are also not able to speak all matters in Tamil. After a few sentences, they switch over to French. Seven, the parents who have acquired the knowledge of English find it very difficult to learn the pronunciation of French words. Hence, they are reluctant to speak in French to the children, thinking that their French will spoil the systematically acquired French of the children. Hence, they speak only Tamil to the children. So, in such cases, the children also maintain Tamil in all domains. So, there are the Indian parents, the Tamil parents, they have gone there after learning English from India. But there are many, plenty of English words used in French, like center, confusion, table. The same spelling is there in French, but the pronunciation is different. Center is pronounced as sound. Confusion is pronounced as confuso. Table is pronounced as table. So the Tamil parents, they are not able to pronounce these words because they have learned English in India. Okay, then the eighth one is, mostly the interjections of French are used when speaking Tamil with another Tamilian. Example, olala, alas. They borrow French words in Tamil very freely. But there is a clear-cut difference found among the Malayali settlers here. In a discourse, very rarely French words are borrowed to Malayalam. They say that French word pronunciation is not suitable along with the pronunciation of Malayalam words in a sentence. In a conversation, a person begins in Malayalam. If he is not able to get exact words, he switches over to French sentences to convey the message. Then again, he continues in Malayalam. Most of them adopt this strategy. But on the contrary, borrowing of lexical items from French is very common among Tamil. The following are some common vocabulary items of French, which are predominantly used by Tamils while they speak Tamil language. I have listed here about 50 nouns. Okay, the last part is that in the Tamil families, the marriage invitations are printed in French and Tamil in the same card. It is to be noted that in the Tamil print, the place names and names of venues will be printed in French. Example, ENVRO, NV Katrale, Kovilil Nadaivaram. Kovilil Nadaivaram in Tamil, and the place name will be in French. In the Tamil invitations, the French prefixes are also used in the Tamil names, like Punurajan, Valli, etc. will be in Tamil. Before, the prefix will be in French, like MR, Mr. ET, et MME. That means Mr. and Mrs. Punurajan will be in Tamil. The above study unraveled the problems faced by the Tamils of Paris to preserve their mother tongue. So the last portion, I will read out the conclusion. Conclusion I will go through very quickly. The mother tongue attrition is slowly taking place. So totally I have found that the mother tongue, either Tamil or Malayalam, the mother tongue attrition is slowly taking place, in the sense already taken place. There is the attrition is already seen, because the second generation children, when they come to the native land, they will not have their mother tongue at all. Then second point is that only partial cultural identity is maintained. What is partial cultural identity means? There are each Tamil people will have so many cultural problems, but all the items they cannot preserve there in the different alien land. Third one is the French language hegemony accelerates the attrition. So the use of French language, that I call as a French language hegemony, accelerates the attrition. Means everywhere only French is there. In a primary school, LKG, UKG, primary school, high school, college, university, hospital, office, bus, train, everywhere only French is used. So there is no question of the use of your own language except your home domain. In home domain also, I have given the home, you can say the home structure. So to say, mainly the French language is a culprit which is accelerating the attrition. But the people, the Tamil people, the Sri Lankan people, or Indian Tamil people, or Malayalams, all are living happily, harmoniously with the French people. That one has to say. Thank you.
Dr. Ravi Shankar. Hello, Dr. Ravi.
Yes, sir. Please, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If you permit, I can.
Yes, sir. You are here.
Start saying something.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. We should thank our speaker, Dr. Rajasekaran, for the wonderful way he presented his experience and also academic interpretation based on the data and observation and so on. Thank you very much. I have a number of comments, but I will restrict to the important ones. I have gone through all these experience in different places on different occasions. Anyway, that's not important. But at the same time, my observations are with reference to one. The use of spoken Tamil by the Tamils of mainland Tamil and also the Jaffna dialect of Tamil. I don't know whether you have observed the way the mainland, you said that they are switching over to Jaffna Tamil, considering that Tamil as, I don't know whether it is standard or superior or whatever it is. But for us, we ill-treat our spoken language by calling it Kochai. Is it a slang? I don't know. But that's how we used to refer to our spoken Tamil. That's the attitude of the 90% of the Tamil population living in India. Okay, this is one thing. Another thing, if you have observed the way the mainland Tamil speakers, how they adopt to the Jaffna dialect. You know, in Jaffna dialect, they have alveolar stop, like Malayalam. I don't know whether you have observed whether they do pronounce alveolar stop in their speech, mainland Tamil speech. That's one thing. There are a couple of grammatical, morphological forms, at least, in their in Jaffna Tamil, especially in pronouns, that to the first person plural, they don't have two pronouns. They have only one pronoun, we. For that, they use only the exclusive plural forms, engal and naangal, which the mainland Tamils use. I don't know how many of us know about that. This is one example. There are a number of such grammatical forms if you elicit and identify and explain. There are other variations as well. Even in possessive case, it is just like engada, right? Engaloda. I don't know which is Kochai. Anyway, it is that is altogether a different issue. This is one thing. The attitudes of the mainland Tamils living in different countries, but I don't know why this kind of attitude is found. One thing. The second thing is the communication patterns which you are mentioning. I think you have also observed the home language. Home language, if you observe, I think the percentage of people using their own mother tongue, the minorities, especially from other countries who have migrated to France or any other country, use, they don't use their mother tongue as home language, maybe probably 40%, 45%. Sometimes, you know, Sri Lankan Tamils make use at least 60-70% make use of their home language. You know, I don't know whether you know about Lee Kuan Yew's views about bilingualism or multilingualism in Singapore. He, after a long gap, he was people brought to his notice about the use of Chinese as home language by 39% of the people only. Then only Lee Kuan Yew felt, oh, it is alarming. Then he introduced teaching methods, asking the teachers, teach contemporary Chinese, not the standard Chinese, contemporary Chinese, that too using linguistic methodology, using English as medium of language first for 3 months. And then he asked them to switch over to modern Chinese. That's what happened in Chinese in Singapore. You know, in other countries also, I am sure they don't practice using their mother tongue as home language. Maybe Sri Lankan Tamils or Jaffna Tamils are good in that. They maintain at least 75%. That too, the younger generation in Canada, in Toronto, they don't use. That is another problem. So, to start with, they use spoken Tamil, and then they switched over to their own language in France or to English in other countries. This is what happened. Even now, in Tamil Nadu, if I begin to give a lecture in the literary Tamil, I don't maintain it for more than a few minutes. Then immediately, I start using spoken Tamil, my Kochai Tamil, if at all, if it is right. So this is the reality, what is happening in language use in not only in other countries, but also in our homeland. Okay, this is another thing. So if this is the practice, then how are we going to study the communication patterns? That is a critical issue, right? They have only that national language or the language of that country where they live. Yes, that is true. They have to make use of that language for all practical purposes. There is no doubt. That's why they have some schools or in a minimum way to teach Tamil language and Tamil culture or Malayalam language, Malayalam culture and so on in a limited way. This is what is happening in many countries. You don't have to blame those countries. We have to follow their own policies and language use. But at the same time, among the Tamils, among the Keralites who have migrated to other countries, they should see that they use that language at least as a home language. For that purpose, bodies like cultural bodies or linguistic bodies are trying their best. I don't say there are no bodies or they don't do anything, but they are doing. But at the same time, they are lack of materials or lack of expertise and so on. So we have a big department in all countries. We have ICCR, Indian Council for Cultural Relations. I don't know what exactly they are contributing, not sending people and receiving people, but at the same time, they should see that they do something for the languages and cultures, Indian languages and Indian cultures, because Indian population is spread over throughout the world, we boast that we are living in 152 countries or so, or 200 countries, I don't know. Anyway, so this is what is happening in the multilingual, multicultural context in other countries as well as India. This is just for out of curiosity, I am giving you these details. You know probably all those details, but at the same time, I am sorry to say that the Tamils consider their spoken language as a slang, and this is wrong. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir, can I make a comment on this? Can I respond to this? Sir, can I? Okay, so I thank Professor Ganagaran for such an elaborate comment on what I have said. But for the first point, I was to say that our mainland Tamils who are settled in Paris, they are not highly professional people. They are, most of them are normal, ordinary people. Only very few. No, they feel that their language is inferior. That is their feeling. I asked many, not only one person. I asked them, "Oh, you sent your children to these children to the school run by the Sri Lankans," and they say that my Tamil is not that good. So at least my son's Tamil should be better. So that is their feeling. They are not linguists. They don't know linguistics. They don't know anything about Tamil language.
No. One has, doesn't have to know linguistics. It is their view, their attitude.
That's
more important.
Yeah.
You don't bother about their education, their specialization. Yeah.
No, something like, sir, suppose somebody says that my shirt is not good, his shirt is good. There is a comparison. No, by looking at likewise, these people say my Tamil is not good, their Tamil is good. That's all.
That is okay. That is okay. But calling it Kocha is different.
Yes, sir.
Sir, any other question, please? Yes.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, please.
Yeah. Mr. Nair,
very
nice to meet you.
Hello, sir.
Very nice. And just I have only two suggestions.
Okay.
One is when the language is not identified with the culture, usually the interest deteriorates. Usually it goes hand in hand.
Yeah.
So we can't separately learn the language and maintain the it is part of culture. Then it is that you have the interest to learn and you will maintain, try to maintain it and all this.
Sir, your voice is very low.
Are you able to hear now?
Yes, you are able to hear, but your voice is very low.
Now, it's okay.
Bring the mic closer.
Volume is leading.
Okay. Is it okay now?
Okay.
And the language is part of culture, and if there is no, we cannot, it has to go hand in hand. You cannot maintain only language and without culture. It's very difficult, and that is why the younger generation, I think, they're not interested in learning the language. And one thing, that is one point, sir. Another is regarding the French Tamils. They learn, they go to the Sri Lankan schools because the formal structure is available only in the Sri Lankan schools. There are other Indian Tamils, they don't offer, I think there's no opportunity to give them such, learn Tamil, our standard Tamil. And that's why the reason maybe they go to the Sri Lankan Tamil. And that is the reason, I think. That is there because they are offering that. But these Indian Tamil, they are not offering such things. They are not available for them, maybe. These are only two suggestions, sir. Okay.
Yeah, that is true.
Yes. Because most of the schools are run by the Sri Lankan Tamils, sir. So their Tamils are closer to the standard form. That is the reason. And I, from my personal experience from the people there, I know that our Tamil land people, they don't run any schools. That is the thing, sir. They are only housewives are they are working like that, sir. I go with the procession's second point. Yes. Any other questions, sir? Please.
Shall I?
Yes.
Ravishankar.
Yes. Please. Yes.
Yeah. Rajasekaran, let me congratulate you first.
For what?
For the whole thing.
And okay. Then.
Okay, and then I have one comment only. When since you told the diaspora in France, there are some more islands which come under France.
Reunion.
Reunion.
I know.
Tamil settled there. They have lost their language, but they have retained their culture.
Okay, right.
Okay, and that kind of a thing you could have added at some point. You
can
didn't
I,
go as a field worker anyway.
Yeah, can I give an answer?
Yeah.
Our friend Dr. Murugayan has done work on that one, and he has published a book also.
Okay,
on the reunions language.
I know.
In my lecture, I have already stated that the data taken only from the people who have settled in Paris and suburbs.
That's right. Okay. I understand. And the second point is, as we are discussing, the Tamil schools are run by Tamil Cholai, by the Sri Lankan Tamils.
Yes.
And the other main Indian Tamils, let's say, or Tamil Nadu Tamils, whoever it may be, they have to learn Tamil in the schools only. The teachers use only Sri Lankan Tamil.
Yes.
But they have some problem. The teachers, our Ravi Shankar also knows that. We know 2-3 teachers, they have a problem of communication in the classroom. When they speak in Sri Lankan Tamil.
Our people may not understand.
They don't understand that. That's the problem there. But still, it's not a question of spoken Tamil of Tamil Nadu or spoken Tamil of this one, Sri Lankan. But this problem they face, and they want us some solution to that. Say they want to switch over to a standard spoken Tamil for the diaspora.
Yes.
This is the problem they are facing now.
No. I also asked the same thing to our Tamil friends. They said that we are French citizens.
Yeah.
We will not be given such opportunities. But whereas the Sri Lankan Tamils are refugees, so they can. But we, although our mother tongue is Tamil, we are part and parcel of Paris, part and parcel of French culture. We are considered to be French people.
Not only historically speaking, the French never wanted the minorities to learn their language. Throughout the history, if you say 1724, they took Tamils to Reunion and Mauritius. Okay, they were prevented to learn Tamil. They learned in that home only. Whereas when Britishers came, or the English came, they allowed these Tamils and other minority languages of Indian or Asian languages to learn their language in the schools. So this dichotomy is there throughout the French world. Okay, so that may be the reason why that the Indian Tamils do not have schools.
Okay.
That may be the reason, but it's historically speaking. Okay, then another one is that you were talking about two magazines or papers, Ira Nadu and Ira Murasu. The other two are Erimalai and Weird Niral.
Okay.
I don't know whether you have mentioned it or not. There are four journals or newspapers coming from France. These two. Okay, thank you very much. You have done a wonderful job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, Selo Kumar.
Yes, please, Selo Kumar.
Okay. Sir, thank you for your nice presentation. So you have brought out from your slides, so the proportionately the Tamil diaspora, whoever you have met over there, and also you mentioned that two places where Tamil speakers are there. That is that Garadu North and Jaffna Tamil, and proportionately that Jaffna Tamilians and Malayalis of the diaspora also you have given the slides. That is so most of them are skilled laborers, I think, so they may have a contact with the people because now that another point which you have brought out, that the French influence is there in their language and all. Definitely, because their profession, it is obvious that they have more contact with them and the influence is there. So only two places you mentioned here, that Little India and Little Jaffna. And if you would have come across the case studies little more depth, so you could have found out the other linguistic diasporas into that. Just one thing I wanted to ask is that have you done any case studies that where you can find the specific language like lingua franca or the particular language which they practice to share their property and responsibility among the diaspora?
No such study I've done it. No. But about the Dravidian languages, the Kannada and Telugu are very, very less in number. So I have not done any work on those.
Do any Malayalis learn Tamil?
As in, no. Malayalis are not. No, in France?
No, in Singapore they do. But do they do it in France?
No. They know when a Malayali meets a Tamil person, the conversation will be in French, but the Malayali is not learning Tamil there. Yeah. Not at all.
I've seen a few Singaporean Malayalis learning Tamil.
Thank you
very much, sir. Thank you. Dr. Venugopal, maybe the identity crisis is there. Perhaps in Singapore and Malaysia, the Malayalis, the Telugus, they learn Tamil. Because that is offered, the language is offered. Because there is a condition that the Indian should learn the Indian language, not the Chinese or Malaysia.
Some prefer Tamil.
Something is there. So they have to learn Tamil. There's no other way. Because out of the four official languages of Singapore,
Hindi to Tamil, and
they have to learn Tamil to Hindi. That's the thing. Maybe this is not possible in France. Because that condition is not there.
Then I'm not quite happy about the term diaspora.
Wait.
Tamils in France. Tamils in France.
No, this is an accepted norm.
Diaspora suggests it is a kind of forced migration.
No, that was started the beginning when the Jews. No, the beginning it was like that. It's a forced movement. But later, that is changed. Now, any kind of migration from one country to another country, the people are called as diasporas.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then one more comment. Eva studied Malayalam from me.
Sure.
Silly Eva studied Malayalam from me.
Okay.
Just a comment.
Oh.
She was there in Calicut University for a few months.
Okay, good.
Rashegran.
Yes.
The lecture was very good. And it is not only the status of Tamil language, it is the state of Kannada and other languages also in the foreign areas.
Okay.
We have three possibilities. Education should be in the mother tongue, or social activity should be in the other mother tongue, or media should be in the mother tongue. If it is not possible, we have to create our own arrangement for that. We have our own organizations where we have to conduct the social activities, cultural activities often. And in the case of Tamil in France, it may not be possible because of the activities are very less because they are not meeting often. And this may lead to the deterioration of the language in that. And secondly, you said it that Tamil language by the Indians is considered to be the inferior to the Sri Lankan Tamil. What is the reason for that?
No, I am not considering, but only those persons who speak Indian Tamil, they say that Tamil.
What made them to feel like that?
I don't know. Probably, probably in some kind of conversations, Sri Lankans
might be told. The Sri Lankan people are coming forward to teach the Tamil language, whereas Indians are not coming for teaching the Tamil language.
The reason may be diglossia in Tamil.
No, sir, I'm sorry. The problem is the domination of Sri Lankan Tamils in schools. That's the only main reason.
That's one.
Because
our people also feel that my language is inferior. That's number two.
That's because of the domination of the Sri Lankan Tamils in the schools. School languages is Sri Lankan Tamil. And I am learning there. So I feel frustrated and I feel my language is inferior to the Sri Lankan dialect. That's all. This is not the common feeling of Tamil dialect of Tamil Nadu is inferior. The feeling in the classroom. They are also facing the same problem. The Sri Lankan teachers, they also face the same problem that we are unable to converse with the Tamil children of Tamil Nadu fluently. They don't understand some words. Of course, as Professor Karnaran was telling, there are some morphological features, some vocabulary. And of course, the pronunciation problem is also there. But it's not a big problem when they come to written Tamil. See, there is a problem as somebody was telling about diglossia. When they switch over to written Tamil, both are same. They don't feel anything wrong. Their Tamil is equal to Sri Lankan Tamil.
But written Tamil is, there is no question of writing Tamil there.
No, that's what I'm telling.
What I'm telling is, sir, can I say?
Yes, sir.
The Tamil has a diglossic, standard spoken and standard written, and local dialectal Tamil also there. Both are there. But normally, we are using them situations only, we speak only the spoken dialects. We don't use, there is no occasion for them to use the standard spoken or written. Therefore, they think that there's no opportunity also to provide them the standard spoken or standard written Tamil. Therefore, they feel it's inferior.
Sir, in the school, they teach the written Tamil only. The problem is only in communication.
Not in France.
Okay.
France situation.
I understood that. In France, what happened is they teach the written Tamil in the school.
Yeah.
But the communication is the problem. The problem is the communication. Communication is possible when this is for standard spoken for both. It's not not at all possible at right now. That's a feeling that they feel inferior to Sri Lanka. Because school is there. They're their own school. I have to talk in their dialect. It's not possible anyway. I have to acquire the Sri Lankan Yalpanam Tamil and then I have to talk. This is the problem. That's what we have been observing in our Ravi Shankar also. We are training the teachers of Sri Lankan Tamils through organizations here. What is that? IATS. They tell the same problem. The teachers feel, teachers also feel how to compromise these two points. Thank you very much. Others can.
Yes, you're right.
Sir, shall I ask questions?
Yes. Can I?
Okay. Yes. Professor Rashtriya Nayan, weatherology and everything is very good. Regarding the attitude of the Indian Tamils in France, entirely different from other country. That attitude is not available now. In Australia, it is not at all available like that. The opinion is different from the only French, the particular people has that attitude. Other country don't have that attitude. Take the case of Singapore or Malaysia or even Australia. When I visited Malaysia, the same case, the second generation lost the mother tongue, the Tamil language, they lost. But the same case is available to some countries. But the attitude is not available there in the Singapore or Malaysia. In Australia also, the attitude is not available. It is a unique case, I think, because of the maybe the school, maybe the teacher, maybe imposed that attitude. Maybe imposed. The imposition is there, I think. Otherwise, it is not at all possible. It's not a Professor Karnaran strongly says that is. I accept that point also because the Kochi is entirely spoken or dialect, or even low prestige. So that word is a very low prestigious word. If you say like that, people feel differently. So Kochi is should be removed. Mm-hmm. You maybe say Tamil language, Tamil Nadu language, or Tamil Nadu Tamil dialect. You can say, but if you say Kochi, it will be some problem in the in the world itself creates some problem. So that's one point. Another point I wanted to say, the many second generation lost the Tamil language. They have the Tamil Sole schools and 17 Tamil associations. They have in Indian Tamil 17 associations. Somehow they lost the language means. We have to look to the government of Tamil also must help. If the case, take the case of Australia government is fully, that ministry, cultural ministry is helping the schools. Even they are sponsoring the place. Like that, is there any possibility in the French government?
Okay.
If they have, here more than 2 lakhs people are living in Tamil, more than both Tamil Nadu and the Indian Tamils and Sri Lankan, more than 2 lakhs people are living in Paris. If you take the case of Australia, they are only nearly 50,000, both Sri Lanka and the Indian Tamils. But they are the school, that cultural ministry, they are helping the Tamil learning schools and other cultural activities, they are helping. Like that, if the government of France helps, definitely they will, the language may be maintained.
Okay, Dr. Pashampad.
Okay.
So can I answer your last question?
Okay.
The government of France has been giving free places for these schools as well as the associations to conduct meetings. The schools run by the Sri Lankans are given by the French government, as well as for our Indian Tamils, there are 17 associations or more. Whenever they conduct meetings, the places, either meeting halls, etc., were given by the French government free of cost. So that way, the French government has been giving importance for such things, either learning your civilization or learning your language. That's there.
Okay, then I have some doubt in the French people language loyalty, because you gave the Professor Murugayan's domination in their family. His son's name is in the Tamil name. His wife is also converted into that Tamil culture. Yeah, actually there is a domination in the Tamil domination in the Murugayan family. I think I'm questioning the language loyalty of the French lady. I'm questioning the language loyalty of the, or culture loyalty of the French lady. How we see how she's changed. Imposed his culture and language. So I am questioning the
loyalty
of the language. Hello?
Okay.
Don't bring any problem to his family.
No.
It is not the domination of... No, it is not the domination of language. It is a male domination.
No.
Whatever may be the domination.
They have been living harmoniously for last many, many years.
Okay. Whatever may the case, but we don't look at our point of view also.
Okay. Right.
We have to appreciate them. See, they have changed their culture and everything. See, we have to appreciate them. So yes. There is no domination at all.
Professor Nair, I like to comment on your paper. It's very, very interesting. I got a lot of information from you. Thanks to you for presenting this paper before us. And I like just one comment I have to make. My sister-in-law is living in Canada. She used to say actually this, there are of course plenty of that. There actually the Sri Lankan population is much more than the so-called Tamil population. And it seems of course they try to have some upper hand over the normal Tamils. with their culture. They seem to be more orthodox compared to the mainland people. But as far as language point of view, they try to imitate the normal the mainland Tamil.
Who the Sri Lankan Tamils imitate Indians?
Yeah. Sri Lankans actually try to imitate the mainland Tamil rather than the. The school situation, I don't know. The school situation, I learned from you only.
Okay.
I heard
that's
from
a, that kind of attitude. It's a reverse case now.
Okay. I see.
Hello, sir.
No,
yes, please.
No.
It's a great.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes,
could I, sir?
Yes,
yeah, may I speak? May I say? Yes, sir. Very good evening. Ellavarkum vanakkam. Honorable dignitaries, myself Girish, student CAS Annamalai University under the guidance of Kumaresan sir. It is indeed a rare privilege to be part of this webinar. And of course, I think actually my query has been answered in the last responses. I would like to just to add that, sir, how about the education institutions? I mean, the teachers and the schools in general, while addressing this, I mean, heterogeneity. How significantly is the culture addressed? I mean, where do the teachers place ourselves in the context? I mean,
especially
in terms of this culture, where do the teachers place themselves? This is what I would like to ask.
Who are the teachers?
Expressing my great gratitude for the lecture you have given, especially to Tamil Moriyal Sangam.
No. Are you?
Thank you, sir. Over.
No, your question is about the teachers of France. Are teachers from France?
Yeah, sir. In the diasporic situations, in order to address the culture diversity, where do they place themselves? How
significant
is the culture address?
I don't know. I have not studied on those things. I think that there is no discrimination at all for those teachers. All the students are alike, whether they speak Tamil or French or Malayalam or Kannada, etc. I feel that there is no distinction for the teachers, but I have not studied. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Can I ask one question, Samo?
Okay.
Yes.
Ravi Shankar, can I ask? Okay. See, both in Canada and France, the Sri Lankan domination is there, no doubt about that. But it is not there in Malaysia. It's a very good lecture, that is a panoramic view of the Tamil diaspora in France, given by Raj Shagar. It's very good. But my question is, the retention of the language, mostly we all know that cultural retention is more when compared to language retention in most of the countries. For example, Malaysia. Malaysia, of course, it's different. Mauritius, Reunion, France, etc. But my question here is the retention of language, that is mother tongue, mostly depends on the concerned persons and the country concerned. Actually, in the family domain, as my experience goes, many households, they like to teach Tamil to their children, but the environment they are in is not allowing them to go deep in their language, mother tongue. As a result, they are not interested. Just they are switching over to French or the language of the concerned country. This is what I feel. This is what I have experienced in some of the countries. And there are some places where they have a organization which can teach Tamil, which are trying their level best to teach Tamil. For instance, South Africa. South Africa, actually, they are trying their level best to teach Tamil, but still, their Tamilists were greater extent restricted to Vanakkam, Nalla Irukkeengala, something like that. So they have inherent, there are some people, organizations which have the inherent tendency to maintain the language, to learn the language, but slowly it is dwindling. But cultural retention is more, yes, of course. Yeah, thank you very much.
Ravi Shankar,
yes, sir.
Just comment on add panniren.
Yes, sir, please, sir. Yes, sir, please.
Oh, yeah. It is about teaching. I was the first professor appointed by the Toronto University when they instituted the Tamil chair there. That was meant for Sri Lankan Tamils migrated in that country. You see, I made use of only the standard Tamil, that which we use in Tamil Nadu. There were 35 students of migrated Sri Lankan Tamils. Now and then I make use of some lexical forms or one or two grammatical forms which I know. During my lecture, nobody hesitated, nobody questioned. It went on very well for 4 months, right? There was another lady also, Dr. Enakku Per Marandu Vache. Anyway, along with me. Adanala, students, you know, they don't expect that we should make use of only their Tamil, especially Sri Lankan Tamil. They wanted to learn Tamil. That's one thing. See, that's how language use goes. But attitudes are different. That is totally a different study. So we don't have to mix both. We are using language as medium of instruction or, you know, for educational purposes, we are using. But the other side is also there, right? This is my experience that I wanted to share. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
As far as diaspora is concerned, I think we have to look at it in two different perspectives. One, where you have the first language generation is keep having no movement from Tamil Nadu to that country. For example, Paris, US, all these places, first generation people are going back and forth. So the retention is possible there through the first generation. The second generation is completely losing the language. Sam Mohanlal and I were in South Africa, and we could see there are no first language generation there. Everybody is second language generation. So they lost their language. So like Sam Mohanlal mentioned, they only say Vanakkam, Vanakkam, that's all. They cannot go beyond that. So Professor, Rajendra Nair mentioned about Paris, they were all first generation. So they are trying to retain the language. They have the schools and all. Just think about it, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, will Paris be like South Africa? Will US be like South Africa and Guadeloupe? We don't know. You know, it depends on the people. You know, we keep going back and forth between these countries. There may be the language retention, some language retention, but not much. So the diaspora Tamil is still endangered, I would say. So I'm not sure how we are going to retain language in a diaspora situation from now or 20 years from now.
I think what Vasu says is correct. That's what is happening. After 10 years or 20 years, slowly it is diminishing. The interest is going on.
But in the case of Myanmar, but the situation is different. These people, Tamil people, they are retaining their culture, the language. Very interestingly, we were there for more than 1 month. At that time, we have noted the language as well as culture is maintained without any defaults. That's appreciable thing that the Tamil people are doing there.
Maintaining culture is different. You know, when we were in a good loop, we could see many people were doing Mariamman Pujai. Like exactly what they did in 1800 in Pondicherry. So when we were in Goodalup, we could see the Pondicherry of 1800. That was so amazing to see how they retained their same culture they brought with them. So as far as the language retention is concerned, how many second generation people will be fluently speaking as Tamil as a mother tongue? That is the question. It's very hard. You know, I've been teaching Tamil here in this US and I'm training language teachers here. That's nature of first language and second language. So you cannot have a first language situation in a foreign country. So that is what is happening.
Natarajan was mentioning about the reunion. Reunion is a very good example. Reunion is a very good example. It's almost lost. They lost. And Mauritius also. Mauritius retention is there. They are trying their level best to retain the language. But it is restricted to their personal names. And somebody has mentioned, I think Rajeshwaran also has mentioned, they are restricted to personal names. Same thing is happening into a greater extent South Africa also. And what Vasu says is correct. After some time, automatically, everything will be lost except the culture. Cultural retention will be there. This is what I feel with my experience.
Ravi, shall I?
Professor Rangan, sir, maybe we
can. Are you able to, is it audible?
Yes, sir.
Audible, sir.
Okay. Go to the other side. In India, there are minorities living for centuries. For example, if you take Tamil Nadu, there are Telugu peoples, there are Marathi people. There is no question of first generation, second generation. In India, the people, the minority people, they retain their language, they maintain the language. But if you compare the Western situation, it is a different, as Professor Vasu said, first generation retain, and the next generation is passive, and the another generation is completely losing its language completely. So there are clearly two kinds of situations in India and in Western countries. Here, there are situations where the language maintenance is there. In Western situation, there are the social or political situations where the language loss is a phenomenon. So if you compare these two, we have to see under what conditions language is maintained, under what conditions language is lost. So let me call my professor Pandit's one. He says that in Western situation, language loss is a common phenomenon. If you come to India, it is the language maintenance that is common phenomenon. So you have to study what kind of social situations or political situations available in different places, and how in one country it is the maintenance is a very common thing, whereas in the other, the loss is a common thing. So this is the one thing I want to just bring to your notice. The other one is, there are two kinds of family situations. Maybe husband and wife, they may speak the same language, as you said. And the other kinds is the husband or and wife, they may speak different languages and they marry. So the first, the family situation is when the husband and wife, they speak different languages, then the first language point starts there. So they have to compromise one with the one language. And another is the outside situation is compelling to speak the language of the majority. So from that point of view, There is one is different languages. The other one is speaking the same languages. Even the people speaking the same languages, they may not use the same language in the family situations always. One question I want to ask, if the children learn the language at from the age of 1 year and 6 months up to 4 years, then if the family situation is ripe for learning the mother tongue, then there won't be any problem, whatever may be the outside situations. So it means the family situation is disturbed, not a monolingual situation, maybe a bilingual situation or some other things. So this child is not exposed to the mother tongue completely in the family situations. If the family situations is the proper place where the children learn their first language, so if that is disturbed, then everything is lost. So that way, one thing. And Professor Mohanlal and Vasu also said that when you talk of in terms of identities, a language identity and then cultural identity, the cultural identity is more strong in the community than the language identity. Even though the language identity is there, it is more of surface level. But the cultural identity somehow or other is retained. For example, take the naming process. So you want to use the names of our religion or whatever it may be, and then we are naming in that pattern. So that way, the cultural identity dominates more than the language identity. One can say Tamils without knowing the language, but he retains the cultural identity. So that way, there is a it is a really a complex situation. I congratulate Professor Nair to give you a very comprehensive picture of situation in France with reference to Tamil and Malayalis and other languages. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Ravi Shankar, shall I make one last comment from me?
Please.
Okay. While I agree with Vasu and Sam Mohanlal about the loss of language, I would like to say one quote, Arinjar Anna, during the First World Conference or Second World Conference, he told, if there is a support from the government, the language will be retained. For example, Mauritius. Mauritius, they have revived the language because of the support of the government. The same way in England now, you see, in the first standard, there are 6,000 children learning Tamil. But at the 10th standard, only 80 children come out. It's because it's not accepted or agreed by the government. They're struggling to get recognition by the government. If they get whatever we are teaching, whatever we are discussing, will become then other way around.
That's true. You know, Professor Balasubramaniam from the Tamil University had an initiated a movement called Tamil Valarchi, Tamil Valar Mandram. With that, you know, we've been going around the world. You know, Myanmar, Murali was talking about Myanmar. With that program, Sam Mohanlal and I went there into Tamil. They didn't have anybody to teach them Tamil for a long time. That was the first time ever they had Tamils teaching them Tamil. They were very proud of that. You know, like you mentioned, that government should take an initiative, like Anna mentioned.
Yeah.
You know, unless the government takes any initiative, population will not retain the language.
For example, Gujarati and Hindi, they have retained the language in England just because the government has agreed upon or let's say recognized the language. Once Tamil is also recognized by the England government, what I feel is the loss will not be there because of our Sri Lankan Tamils. That's all.
We have a very good opposition, contrasting situation in our neighboring countries, Singapore and Malaysia. Singapore has a support, government support on the language. So we have a very good the retention of the language as well as culture in Singapore. But when compared to Malaysia, there is no government support. As a result, if you in Malaysian situation, Narajan must be knowing, in Malaysian situation, these Tamil schools, the strength is dwindling. Though they are trying their level best to maintain, but children are not interested. Slowly it is coming down. This is what I have experienced in Malaysia. There is a lot of effort from different Tamil organizations to maintain the language. Of course, they are maintaining. But as Vasu says, after certain, probably a couple of decades, I do not know the position in this Tamil position in Malaysia, whether it may be quite deplorable. But Singapore, yes, that's one of the official languages. So it is going on. Thank you.
Hello, like that, sir? Australia also, their government is supporting.
Hello, sir. Can I add? Ravishankar? Ravishankar?
Australia also is supporting the Tamil language.
Dr. Vishankar, I want to speak for a minute.
Yeah.
Dr. Vishankar.
Sir, with
your permission, I take 1 or 2 minutes to make quick comments. Professor Rajasekhar Nair started with the brand situation in this. Tamils in France, this discussion covered the entire world. I appreciate the professors for contributing to the diasporic situation, maybe that it goes in the entire world. That is one thing. Regarding Professor Vasu was telling about Tamil Valar Mayam, it is Tamil Valar Mandram, not Mandram, that is Tamil Valar Mayam, initiated, supported by the Tamil Nadu government, and we are having centers all around the world, for example, in America, in France, in England, in Sri Lanka, in many, we are starting the centers to teach Tamils. And there are demands. The demands are not for getting any certificates. Now, in some countries like Norway and other places, they want the education study, the Tamil studied by them, to be recognized as multilinguals by the government. Even I got recommended to some governments to recognize the language as the learners as multilinguals. Then they get the credit. That is one thing, as rightly pointed out by some scholars, that if government supports, Narajan Pillai was telling, if government is supporting, then it will grow. Then one more recent development I should say to the audience, these learned professors, that in US, they want some kind of training to the teachers and a certificate. Now we are going to start a certificate and diploma courses in Tamil teaching. We have already started the process, and we are going to train the teachers across the world to teach Tamils. So if they are given the training, for example, our people already told Professor Shamoganal and Professor Vasaranga were telling, and Professor Murali also, we send people to Mauritius, people to Myanmar and South Africa. We are also going to the reunion, and we are going and training them on spot. And at the same time, we are going to give them certificates and diplomas to the teachers who are teaching Tamil there, and that will go a long way. That is what I feel. Thank you very much, and we want to thank the Tamil Nadu government also for their financial support. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Ramamurthy wanted to say.
I am tempted to talk about Konkani in Kerala. No governmental support, no support from anybody, but Konkani is retained by Konkani speakers, just because of caste identity.
It's also possible.
One of the reasons for retention in India, the retention of the minority language in any part of India is probably also due to the caste act. When this is lost, they lose their language. Nothing to be worried about. It happens.
Okay, thank you, sir. I think Professor Ramamurthy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
First of all, you know, I joined in the last peg of your lecture.
Yeah, you know.
General question. What we have been discussing about the diasporic studies, all are, I in my perspective, it's all are things of past. So we have to, you know, see the diasporic studies in a different perspective. You know, this is the era of globalization. We are talking about borderless countries, and the technology is also fast growing. And in the technological perspective, we are seeing that language is moving towards visual media and also towards spoken form. So these things has to be taken into consideration. And post-ethnic in Sri Lanka and movement because of this, you know, haptic money, this technological people, even in the first generation itself, I have seen in my own family, my own brother's son who has settled in America recently, he could not, you know, inculcate the sense of mother tongue to his daughter. The first generation itself is losing their mother tongue. So we have to see in a different perspective. Now, totally throw
some problem with your mind.
Yeah, I'm seeing the problem is lost.
Okay.
There is a Mr. Rajshekhar is raised his hand.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Rajshekhar, audience.
That
will be the final
question,
huh?
Okay.
So
he's not there, perhaps.
Hello? Hello?
Yes?
Sir, can I talk? Professor Babaji.
Yes, sir. Please,
yes,
sir.
Yeah, only thing is, this is when the it is comes to the question of learning mother tongue in the foreign countries, when it, for the first generation, it becomes a mother tongue. But for second generation, it becomes a second language. It actually the situation is the second language. They are not learning in the same situation as mother tongue is learned by the first generation. And it is as though it's almost learning the second language because the domains of use is very restricted. And even when they come out of the house, they have to speak of the other language, switch over to the other language. And therefore it is like learning a second language. And another thing is the government's policies for France, I don't know whether you have the language policy, two or three language policies. And whether Tamil is included in the school or not, I want to know, please.
No, Tamil is not included in the curriculum.
Regular school's curriculum.
No, it is not there.
No. So Tamil is not included in our regular curriculum in any of the diaspora countries. That's the problem. Yeah. Except for Singapore and Malaysia. No other country. I mean, I think in Mauritius also they do that. So that is what we are trying. So we want to have Tamil included in the regular curriculum, but it is very hard. Maybe, if that happens, language retention may be good.
Maybe
but,
because of the
that won't happen.
Maybe because of the concentration of population.
Population yeah, see, the Tamil, the governments have their own policies about language. So this
probably,
may not matter to them at all.
Vasu, the Vice Chancellor of Tamil University, as Professor Balasubramani was telling, the Tamil University is trying to teach Tamil in different countries. That is good. But as a vice chancellor, through the government of Tamil Nadu, if we can also initiate what Vasu says to the various governments to include curriculum at least in certain level. Probably
that's possible if the Indian
difficult.
Government takes that initiative.
Difficult.
If the Indian government takes that initiative,
it has to be done by the government.
Yes.
Yeah.
Single professor cannot do anything.
Mm-hmm.
See, recently something happened in Tamil Nadu in one of the universities. So it will take a lot of time.
Very difficult.
Hindi
is
taught in many schools.
It's a task.
In the US, for example, but not Tamil.
Yeah.
They can come to an end.
Yes,
yeah. One quick note I would like to mention, Professor Rajasekhar Nair mentioned a book about the diaspora. That was the conference proceedings from Guadeloupe in France. We have many articles in that. So I have written an article in that on language retention in diaspora. And Professor Ramarmurthy also wrote an article in that book. So if you have a chance to read that book, please read. We have many articles around across the globe about language retention in diaspora. Yeah, please have a look at
Yes,
sir.
Rajasekharan wants to say something.
Yes, sir. I don't know, because there was a very good discussion which I never thought of. Maybe the topic is useful for everyone, and all joined for the discussion. And from the discussion, I also learned many things. So, so I thank all the participants who have participated in the discussions. Thank you all.
Yes, sir. Your lecture was very productive, sir. It has given more information to the audience. We get to what is happening all over the world regarding the teaching and learning of Tamil. Thank you very much, sir. And it is time that I invite Dr. Kumaresan to say word of thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Kumaresan?
Thank you. Is it audible?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes.
Good evening to all. I'm happy to propose a formal word of thanks to organizers, participants, and today's speakers of the series of lecture, Professor N. Rajasekharan Nair. My special thanks to Tamil Moliyal Sangam President, former Vice Chancellor K. Karunakaran, and General Secretary, present Vice Chancellor G. Balasubramaniam. Both are the visionary personality. To other executive members and AC members of Tamil Moliyal Sangam, our sincere thanks to the valuable participants like Professor Murugappa, Professor Rangan, Professor Nadana Sabhapathi, Professor Nadaraja Pillai, Professor Jnanasundaram, Professor Rangan, Professor Shanmugam, Professor Vasu, and so on, who are actively involved in the discussion and the session, especially Professor Karunakaran, Nadana Sabhapathi, Nadaraja Pillai, and Selu Kumar, Venugopala Panikkar, and Rajendran sir, and my scholar Girish from Kerala, and Shamohanlal, Rangan sir, and others. Before that, I would like to share something about the proposal, the word of thanks of our Tamil Moliyal Sangam organizing committee decided to the proposed the word of thanks may be fixed the speaker topic related person. So in this manner, myself is the apt person today's the word of thanks, because I have prepared for the PhD syllabus for Indian diaspora in the academic year 2019-20. So our center has offered the PhD in Indian diaspora from the 2019 onwards. Those who are interested to work in this area, please contact our director, CS Linguistics, Annamalai University. Now I share with a few words about our today's speaker. Professor N. Rajasekharan Nair Iyer is my guide, well-wisher, and mentor. Today's lecture is thought-provoking and more benefits of the in the Tamil diasporic person in France and other places. Thank you very much, sir. I thank the technical peoples like Sundarabalu, Dr. Vijayan, Dr. Sangar Ganesh, and other the persons like contact persons like Dr. Umaraj and Dr. Ramesh Kumar. I thank you very much. Last but not least, Professor Kamachi, Professor Ramamurthy, Professor Ravi Shankar, and Professor Muralidharan have planned to the speakers of the lecture of the series and support the need of our Tamil Moliyal Sangam in our time. So once again, I thank one and all. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
வணக்கம் எல்லாருக்கும் வணக்கம் சார்.